Good evening, Rock Church. How are you doing tonight? Are you excited to be in the house of God? Amen. I'll tell you what I'm excited about tonight. And, you know, I'm glad to be with such a group of people. I'm glad to be with you. You say, what kind of people is that? That's the kind of people who say, you know what? I know it's Super Bowl Sunday, but I got to make some time to get into the house of the Lord. Because up in the house of the Lord, God is present, his power and his glory. And boy, it makes all the difference in my life. And so, man, I'm excited to be with all of you today. You could be seated this evening. Hey, as he said, my name is Joseph, one of the pastors here at The Rock. I consider myself to be on the teaching team here at The Rock, not because I'm up here very often, but because I do my teaching, as Pastor Luke said, over the young adults and the youth ministry. By the way, are there any Shift young adults in the house tonight? There we go, there we go. And if you are a young adult, you're between the ages of 18 and 30, I want to invite you out to a Friday night. We have service every Friday night at 7 o'clock. And the service is designed specifically for you. And so if you're free, we'd love to have you come out. You're going to have a blast. You're going to get touched by God, and it's going to be amazing. Actually, we're in the middle of a series called The Social Experience. And so if you want to know what that's about, you're going to have to come out and experience it for yourself. Amen, amen, all right? So, right over here on the front row, I'm going to embarrass my wife for just a moment. Honey, if you'll stand up and just kind of wave at everybody real quick just so you can see. My wife, we've been married now nearly 7 years. It'll be 7 years in May. We have two kids, Judah and Madeline, and I am totally blessed. We are totally blessed. God is good. Well, enough about me. What do you say we get into the Word of God tonight? All right. If you're taking notes, the title of my message is this: Grace That's Greater. And before we get into the Word of God, let's go ahead and pray. Father, we come before you today in Jesus' mighty name. God, we thank you for this opportunity to come into your house and to meet up with you. God, I thank you for what you've already done in the hearts and lives of the individuals here. And Lord, I thank you for their diligence to come into the house of God tonight. And Lord, I know that you'll honor their coming and you'll bless them all the more this evening. Holy Spirit, speak to their hearts. Holy Spirit, speak to my heart. Do the work that you do so well, Lord, that only you can do. Give us the truths that we need for today, that we need for tomorrow, or that we can carry with us for the rest of our lives. And God, will give you all the praise, all the honor, and all the glory in Jesus' mighty name. And everybody in agreement with that said? Amen. 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 Well, as I said just a moment ago, today I'd like to talk to you about grace. Grace is truly amazing. Amen. Not only is it amazing, though, grace is really vital for Christian living. And if you're going to live life as a Christian, really the way to live life as a Christian is to live it with God's grace. Without grace, you'll find the Christian life. You'll find fulfilling God's purposes for your life, walking out the will of your life, rather difficult, if not impossible. Grace is really vital for Christian living. And it's for this reason that, you know what, if you look at God's Word, what you'll find is that grace is all throughout the Word of God. From Genesis to Revelations, from beginning to end, the book is full of God's grace. And that's because grace is the means by which God works his purposes and his will in the lives of men and women just like you and just like me. The book is full of God's grace, and you've got to do life by God's grace. Actually, the first time, if I could just do this, the first time that you'll find the word grace in the Bible is in Genesis chapter 6. And I think everybody here is probably a little bit familiar with the story of Noah. The Bible says that, you know what, the days of Noah were really kind of grim. It was really kind of an ugly time, really kind of a dark time. Listen, if you think things are bad right now, you should have tried living in the days of Noah because they were really bad. The Bible says that as far as humanity was concerned, that every intention and every thought of their heart was only evil continually. My goodness, what a time to live. And so the Bible says that God regretted that he had made man, and he decided that, you know what, I need to bring an end to this. But all of a sudden you come to Genesis chapter 6 and verse number 9, and this is what it says. It says, but Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. And then what happens right after that? Well, God gives Noah the plan. He says, all right, this is what I need you to do. I need you to go build an ark. Now, could you imagine Noah at the time like, okay, God, that's really cool. I like that, but what's an ark? Right? I mean, nobody had done anything like that before. And so God goes ahead and gives him the plan. And the Bible says over the next 120 years that Noah was about the business of building this ark and preaching about God. Well, guess what happened? Only Noah and his family were saved. That tells me this then, that you know what? In Noah's day, Noah was the only one serving God at the time.
How did Noah make it? How did Noah do it? He did it by the grace of God. But Noah found grace in the eyes of God. Hey, listen, you know what? Today, if you're finding it difficult to live the Christian life in the environment that you're in at the job, if you're finding it difficult to live the Christian life among your family who may not be saved, listen, I've got good news for you. God's grace carried Noah through it, and God's grace can carry you through it today. What you need in the house today is a little bit of God's grace. And then if you move on and you go into the New Testament, right, the first time you'll find grace in the New Testament is actually in Luke chapter 2, verse number 40. And it's a verse about Jesus. And it says the child grew, right? After Jesus was in a manger, he left the manger behind. He grew up. The Bible says that the child grew. He became strong in spirit, filled with wisdom, and the grace of God was upon him. Do you want to know how Jesus did it? Do you want to know today how Jesus made it? Jesus made it because the grace of God was upon him. And my dear friend today, listen, if that's how Jesus did it, how many realize today that that's how I need to do it too? That's how you're going to make it. That's how you're going to fulfill God's plan for your life. It's through the grace of God. You move on to the book of Acts, and the Bible says that, all right, Jesus has now ascended, and you've got these disciples now who have been given the responsibility to spread the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. And it says that they gave powerful witness to Jesus Christ. And it says, and the grace of God was upon them. My goodness, how did they do it? With the grace of God. You want to know how the Bible ends? Have you ever read the last verse of the last book? It says, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you. The book is full of grace, full of grace. Looking more a little bit more at the New Testament, not too long ago, I realized this, that did you know that 17 of the 22 epistles in the New Testament begin with this statement, grace to you from God the Father and our Lord Jesus Christ? Now, just to make sure everybody understands what we're talking about today, because in the New Testament, the different books in the New Testament, they're categorized in a few different ways, okay? First, the first four books of the New Testament, right, you guys know what those are, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Those are what we call Gospels. They contain the story of the life of Jesus Christ, the good news. And then you have Acts. It's kind of a standalone book, right? It doesn't really have a category. I call it the bridge book, okay? And that's because it connects the Gospels with all the books that follow. Well, all the books that follow, Romans through Revelations, those are called epistles. An epistle is just a fancy word for the word letter, okay? And they were letters written by men of God to different churches and to different individuals. Well, 17 of the 22 epistles, that's Romans through Revelation, begin by saying, grace to you from God the Father and our Lord Jesus Christ. Can I just show you a few, all right? Just give your attention to the overhead screen real quick. In Romans chapter 1, verse number 17, it says this. It says, to all who are in Rome, beloved of God. Anybody here beloved of God? If Jesus is Lord, you are beloved of God. It says, called to be saints. Anybody here a saint of God? Look what it says. It says, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Guess how 1 Corinthians starts? 1 Corinthians starts the same way. And again in 2 Corinthians and Galatians and Ephesians and Philippians and Colossians. Now, not every book starts this way. I think it's kind of funny because if you go to, like, for example, the book of James, James just simply says, greetings. Hey, count it all joy when you fall into various trials, knowing that the testing of he just goes on with what God has to say. All right, so yes, it's a greeting, but 17 of the 22. Let me ask you this: does anybody here think that God's trying to say something? God is trying to say something, and what God is trying to say tonight to you is that grace is reaching out for you tonight. Grace is reaching out. Grace to you from God the Father and our Lord Jesus Christ. A couple more here. First Peter chapter 1, verse number 2. Watch this. It says this. Elect according to the foreknowledge of God the Father in sanctification of the Spirit for obedience and sprinkling of the blood of Jesus Christ. Grace to you and peace be multiplied. I like that. Peter has a grasp on multiplication. Watch this. 2 Peter chapter 1, verse number 2. Grace and peace be multiplied to you in the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord. Hey, tonight, Rock Church, grace to you. Grace to you from God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Grace. Hey, somebody tonight, shake your neighbor's forearm. Just grab their forearm, shake a little bit. Say, hey, grace is reaching out to you. Grace is reaching out to you tonight. Turn to the person and shake their forearm too. Say, hey, grace is reaching out for you tonight. Grace is reaching out for you tonight. What a comfort, right? What a comfort, what an encouragement to our hearts to know that what's coming from God tonight is the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, tonight, if you're not quite as excited as I am, maybe you just need a little refresher as to what grace is. What is grace, actually? If you want to get technical, all right, this is how you know, you can translate from Greek into English. Grace is this, God's unmerited favor. That's what grace is, God's unmerited favor. But then the question I'm sure is going to come along at some point, like, okay, so what does that look like? Anybody here ever been favored by somebody you didn't really want to be favored by? You know what I'm talking about? Man, Pastor Luke, I was expecting him to tease me just a moment ago. So I was going to like, and he just has said so many nice things, like I can't tease him anymore. But I guess I'm going to have to because it's kind of part of my message now. But you know what? Sometimes I don't like the favor Pastor Luke shows to me. Because Pastor Luke's favor to me is a teasing favor. And sometimes I just think, man, why you got to always be jabbing at me, man? Why you always got to be poking at me? But you understand today, right? Like you can say unmerited favor, but what exactly does that mean? Well, I'm so thankful today that we have a senior leadership team that has taught us so well about grace. I mean, if grace is amazing and grace is vital and we need it, then aren't you thankful for an awesome leadership team that has taught us well about what grace really is? So we can have a grasp on it. So what I want to do is, all right, so what does unmerited favor look like? What I want to do is I want to pull up a few definitions of grace. And from these definitions, we're going to extract some truths. Is that all right? All right, now the first one comes from Pastor Jim, all right? And I'm sure that you know it, everybody out there, and so I thought it'd be cool that we all kind of say it together. So if I could get that first definition of grace up on the overhead screen here, and this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to say grace is, and then everybody's going to join in together, and we're going to finish, we're going to say the definition, okay? This comes from Pastor Jim, all right? Everybody ready? Are you sure? Okay, all right. Grace is God's sovereign divine ability to get the job done on my behalf when I can't do it. God's ability to get the job done on your behalf when you can't do it. Is anybody here thankful today? Okay. Let me say this. Is anybody here thankful today that, you know what, when you've come to the end of yourself, when you don't have the strength anymore, when you don't have the ability anymore, when you don't have the wisdom anymore, when you don't have the knowledge anymore, anybody here thankful today that, you know what, when medical science has come to an end, when technological science has come, advancements have come to an end, when nobody on earth can do what you need to get done, God can still come through and do what for you, what no other power can do. Come on, somebody. He's the God of the impossible. And this is the kind of thing that's reaching out for you today. Can I just take a moment to remind you, hey, this is the God who speaks and planets come into existence. This is the God who split the Red Sea and his people walked across, not on some muddy, mushy ground, but on dry ground, the Bible says. This is the God who calls the sun and the moon to stand in their place for over 24 hours, and there are no consequences whatsoever. This is the God who said to some dry, dead, long dead bones, I want some flesh to start growing on you. And the flesh started to grow, and these people came back to life. My goodness, this is the God who opens the blind eyes, who opens deaf ears. Come on, the mute speak, the lepers are healed, the dead are raised. Come on, somebody. And then just when the devil thought he had him beat, he himself rose from the dead victorious with all power. My goodness. He's the God of the impossible. He's a God of miracles. And he's the same yesterday, today, and forever. And you know what? When you've come to the end of yourself, whether it's your marriage or in your job or your finances or wherever it is, God can still and will still come through on your behalf and get the job done. Grace, God's ability to get the job done on my behalf when I can't do it. The second definition comes from Pastor Deborah. And we're going to pop it up on the overhead screen. We're going to do the same thing again, and we'll say it all together, all right? All right, so you're ready? Remember how this works? Grace is God's power in me to do what God's truth demands of me. God's power in me to do what truth demands of me. I like this one. This one's a little bit intriguing for me. This one I kind of like to look into and think about. This one kind of says to me this, that, you know what, sometimes my issue my situation, my problem, if you will, is not always external. Sometimes my issue, my problem, is internal. Isn't that right? And sometimes the answer to my external problem is an internal fix. Let me say that again, because I'm not sure if everybody got here today. All right, sometimes the answer to my outward problem is an internal fix. Sometimes the way that God has to go about changing what you're experiencing is in the world around you is to first come and change who you are, how you think, what your habits are. God oftentimes has to come along and deal with you and me. Can I just say it this way? Can we just be honest in the house of God today? You know, let me do this. I'm going to start with myself just to make it easy for everybody, all right? We're gonna try to make this go over really, really nice and really gentle and really graceful. Amen. All right? All right. And so let me say it this way. Sometimes I am my biggest problem. Why are you guys saying so? Amen. So no, it's fine. No, I'm just kidding. Okay. Let's make sure that we got this. Sometimes you are your biggest problem. And the way that God's going to bring about the change, and the way that God is going to bring about what he has for your life outwardly, is to first deal with you inwardly. Now tonight, how many of you ever found it difficult to deal with yourself? Right? And a lot of times we just want to pass the buck. We want to blame the wife. We want to blame the dog. We want to blame all kinds of stuff, right? We give up and we cave in and we quit and all this kind of stuff, because sometimes it's difficult to deal with yourself. And you know, many people have lost the fight dealing with self. But that's where God's grace comes in. Because God has the ability to change in you what you have never been able to change about yourself for years. God's grace. And you know what? If you will allow grace to come into your life and transform you, transformation will translate into a different experience in the world around you. If you'll let God's grace to come into your life and do what God's grace wants you to do. Now, can I just say this? This is what God's grace is actually trying to do in your life. It's trying to make you more like Jesus. I can't tell you how many people I've talked with over my life, youth and young adults. All right, we'll just talk about youth and young adults. There's nobody in here tonight, okay? But oftentimes we get this thought, you know, have you ever heard somebody say, well, I'm not Jesus? Right? Right? Right, because the thought is, you know, Jesus, he was the Son of God. He was the spotless, perfect Lamb, and I can't be like that. And actually, if you look at Scripture, what you'll find is that God says you can be like that, and that's how I want you to be. Romans chapter 8 says, "Whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son." You are supposed to be the image of Jesus Christ. You know, the Bible says that Jesus is the image of the Father, right? And he came to reveal the Father. Well, now Jesus is gone, and now it's our responsibility to reveal the Son. You are supposed to be the image of Jesus Christ. And you can do it. And the way that you do it, and the way that you're going to get there, is by the grace of God. Let me just say it to you like this. This is how Paul described it. Christ in me, the hope of glory. Christ in me, the hope of glory. The inside, something on the inside, working on the outside. Oh, what a joy in my life. Okay, two of you got that. All right, let's move on. Grace, God's power in me to do what God's truth demands of me. A couple more thoughts about this. I heard somebody say this, that most people fail to change until the pain of not changing becomes greater than the pain of changing. One more time for everybody. Most people fail to change until the pain of not changing becomes greater than the pain of changing. Guess what? You don't have to wait till things get that bad. Just let God's grace take you over. Come on, somebody tonight, grab your neighbor and shake them and say, just let Jesus take you over. Just let Jesus take you over. Amen. Let Jesus take you over. Third definition tonight. Pop it up on the overhead screen. Now tonight, let me say this as they're popping that up. You know, maybe you're thinking today, why does grace have so many definitions? You know, why? I mean, and the reality is that it's really hard to, you know, pin grace down. It's really hard to pigeonhole grace, because grace is just so multifaceted. You know, it takes on various forms. It expresses itself in so many different ways. And so, grace is really God's unmerited favor. What does that look like? Well, we've been kind of looking at it to help you get a feel and a grasp for what it's like. But the reality is that, you know what, grace has the whole of the human life covered. It just applies to every area of your life. You can't move yourself to a place where grace doesn't apply. It's just impossible. And that's what makes grace so hard to define, okay? And so that's why we kind of have so many different definitions. But here's definition number three. Grace is God's ability to live a victorious life. Okay, let's try that again, because, all right, remember how this works? Grace is, okay, and, all right, I messed up that time. All right, here we go. Grace is God's ability to live a victorious life. I don't know if you got it a moment ago, but the first definition kind of dealt with, you know, we kind of said that grace helps us with the external things in life, right? The second definition, we kind of said grace helps us with the internal things of life. But maybe you didn't catch it. It doesn't matter if your problem is external or your problem is internal. Grace has got you covered. And grace will lead you in a victorious life. Hey, you know what today? If you're a Christian, God's called you to be a winner. God's called you to beat up on life instead of life beating up on you. Yeah. God's called you to beat up on the devil instead of the devil beating up on you. You got to get a new picture of yourself. You got to wake up in the morning and look in the mirror and say, I'm a winner. I'm a winner. The Bible says you're more than a conqueror. You're not just a conqueror. You are more than a conqueror, and you are more than a conqueror by God's grace. I like how they said it in Tulsa, Oklahoma, in the Midwest. I can't lose for winning. Mignon knows that. All right, so nobody on the West Coast understands that. So let me see if I can explain it for you, because I did have a little bit of shell shock when I went out and I heard them saying, I was trying to figure it out. All right, so it's kind of like, let me make the statement again, okay? I can't lose for winning. That means if somehow you were trying to turn things around so that somehow I would get a loss for winning too much, it wouldn't happen, because all I do is win. You follow me today. And God's called you to win in life. Whether the issue is external or whether the issue is internal, God's called you to be a winner. Hey, listen, sometimes things don't work out in the time frame that you'd like them to work out. And sometimes it seems like you may take a little loss here and there, okay? So I'm not trying to say today that, you know, everything in life is supposed to be peachy keen. But how many realize I might lose the battle, but I might lose the battle, but as far as the war is concerned, I'm going to win. And God's called you to live a victorious life. And the way that you're going to live the victorious life is through God's grace, God's ability to take care of what needs to be taken care of, God's power to take care of what needs to be taken care of. Romans chapter 5, verse number 17 says this. Go ahead and turn there with me real quick. I've been quoting a lot of verses, and I apologize if I've kind of left you in the dust a little bit. I need to work on that, I suppose. But Romans chapter 5, verse number 17 says, the Bible says it very clearly like this. It says, for if by the one man's offense, speaking of Adam, death reigned through the one, much more those who receive abundance of grace and of the gift of righteousness will reign in life through the one, Jesus Christ. I don't think you could say it any clearer than that. If you're willing to receive abundance of grace, what grace is going to do is cause you to reign in life, win in life. Let me take you now to James chapter 4. James chapter 4. And let's look at verse number 6. James chapter 4, verse number 6. This is going to show us the same principle. It says here, we're just going to look at the first sentence for now. It says here, but he gives more grace. But God gives more grace. If If you look at that word more in the Greek, all right, you actually find that really this verse is better translated this way, okay? But he gives greater grace. That word more really should probably be better translated greater. Actually, the NASB translates it that way. But he gives greater grace. Greater than what, Pastor Joe? Greater than whatever issue you face. You don't understand. I got some serious marital issues. But he gives greater grace. You don't understand where I'm at in my finances. He gives greater grace. You don't understand what my past has been like and how I've been hurt, but he gives greater grace. You don't know what they did to me. You don't know what they said to me. You don't know what's going on the job, Pastor Joe. Hey, listen, he gives greater grace, and grace will always come along and overwhelm your situation and bring you the victory if you will allow it. Grace is God's empowerment to live a victorious life, but he gives greater grace. Grace that's greater than any one of your issues. Grace that's greater than any one of your problems. Grace that's greater than any one of your situations, any one of your circumstances. Listen, it doesn't matter where you find yourself. You know, in 2011, my wife gave birth to our firstborn, Judah. And boy, that was at a difficult time. Judah had what's called congenital heart disease. And Judah had 3 open heart surgeries by the time he was, 3 or 4 months? 4 months old. The second heart surgery, I particularly remember the most because after the surgery was done, they brought him back to his room on the operating table. And because there was so much cutting, there was so much bleeding that they could not close his chest. So they brought him back to the room, and I'm sitting there, and my son's chest starts here and opens up to about a 2-inch gap all the way up here. And the reason for that is because they had to let the bleeding bleed out, not get stuck in there. All right, and then once the bleeding stopped, then they can close them all the way up. You know, can I just say something to everybody today? We had family members who came to visit us who were weeping and crying and literally falling on the floor. Me and my wife, somehow we had the ability to stand strong and to stand in faith, and somehow I had the peace of God in my heart. And let me tell you what it was that carried me all the way through. It was God's grace. I can't take any of the glory tonight. I can't say that I'm such a great Christian, or I'm such a great this, or I'm such a great that. It was God's grace that carried me through. So all I'm trying to say to you tonight is, it doesn't matter where you find yourself, grace will overwhelm your situation. And grace will bring you the victory. Grace will bring you the victory in your marriage, in your family, in your ministry. How many of you here are interested in fulfilling God's purpose and God's destiny for your life? Grace. You're going to do it by grace. All right, we've talked a lot about grace. So if grace is really this amazing and really this vital, all right, then how do I get a hold of this grace, right? All right, if grace is reaching out to me, how do I get a hold of this grace? I got 2 quick points. Is that all right? And then we're done. 2 quick points. You can handle 2 quick points, right? Okay. Technically, this is point 4 and 5, but I did it so you wouldn't. All right. Anyways. All right. Point number 1 is this. Grace comes through knowledge. 2 Peter chapter 1, verse number 2. Hold your place there in James. All right. We're going to come right back to James. 2 Peter chapter 1, verse number 2. We actually ought to read it. It says this. It says, grace and peace be multiplied to you. Notice what he says next. In the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord. How are you gonna lay hold of grace? How are you gonna get this amazing grace to, you know, come into your life and really become active? It's gonna come into your life through knowledge. Specifically here, the knowledge of God. Simply put, as you get to know God more, you'll find more grace accessible to you. The more you get to know about God, the more you get to know about how he operates, the more you get to know Jesus and walk with Jesus and learn of Jesus and learn of his ways, the more grace will be available to you. It comes through getting to know God. You and I, you know what? You know, the greatest calling in life, you want to know what it is? The greatest calling in life is to know Jesus personally and to know him intimately. You know, of all the wonders that and all the accomplishments that Paul the Apostle accomplished, I mean, for crying out loud, I don't think there's a minister alive that's ever reached, you know, the heights of Paul the Apostle. Wrote 2/3 of the books of the New Testament. I mean, come on, have you written the book of the Bible? If you have, we're going to pray for you, all right? But anyway, all right. And what was I talking about? God's grace, right? Grace. Okay, I remember. All right, Paul, of all the things that he accomplished, of all the heights that he reached and that he attained, if you look at the book of Philippians, this is what he says, that there's no greater calling than to know. He says, I let everything else fall to the side for this one purpose, to reach this one thing, and that is to know Jesus Christ, my Lord, and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his suffering. That, and you read in the Amplified, that I may come to know him and become acquainted with the wonders of his person. It's the greatest calling in life, to know God. And I'm here to tell you today that the more you get to know God, the more grace, God's grace, will be available to you. And so we should be about the business of pursuing God. Hey, listen, there's more of God today than you've ever experienced before. I don't care if you've been saved 35, 55, 85 years. There's still more of God to be experienced. There's still more of God to be realized. There's still more of God's glory to capture your heart and do great things in your life. You know, just when you think you know everything about God, God comes along and blows your mind all over again. And so for the rest of our lives, we should be getting to know God. And all I'm simply saying to you today is the more you get to know God, all right, the more grace will be available to you. You know, man, I can't believe I'm quoting so much and I don't not taking you there and showing it. All right. One more example of Paul. In 2 Corinthians chapter 12, Paul makes this statement. He says, you know what? Because of the abundance of revelations that came into my life. Revelation, that's a fancy word for truths revealed, truths about God. Because of the abundance of revelations that came into my life, I was exalted above measure. I was living life on a whole different plane than everybody else. I was, anybody here want to live the high life? Okay, all right, you know what the high life I'm talking about, right? Okay, we're talking about the high life of God. Sorry. Sometimes you have to clarify. Listen, if you want to live the high life, it's going to come by you learning more about God and God's grace taking you to that place. All right? So that's how you get God's grace. You got to get to know God more. Point number two, how do I get this grace? Point number two is this: grace comes through humility. Go back to James real quick, and we're going to close with these last thoughts. James chapter 4, verses 6 and 7. Actually, just verse number 6, I lied. James chapter 4, verse number 6. It says, but he gives more grace, or he gives greater grace. Therefore, he says, God resists the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Real quick, what is humility? Humility is the ability to give up your way to do things God's way in a relatively quick manner. One more time. What is humility? Humility is the ability to give up your way for God's way in a relatively quick manner. See, we said our last definition, right, was that God's grace is God's empowerment to live a victorious life. God's grace wants to take you somewhere. But as long as you're not willing to go that place, you're never going to experience the victory. You follow? You know, okay, Peter, right? You remember Jesus, after a long day of ministry, he tells his disciples, I want you to get in the boat, I want you to cross over to the other side. And he stays behind. And Jesus goes ahead and spends some time praying. And then the Bible says they're out in the middle of the sea, and Jesus comes walking on the water. And some of the disciples freak out, oh my God, it's a ghost, and all this kind of stuff. You know how we get, right? We're real suspicious, and right? People can be real, we can be real suspicious. And they're like, it's a ghost, and it's a Jesus ghost. It's, I don't know what it is, right? And then Peter shouts out, he's like, no, it's Jesus. And then this is what Peter does. Peter says, Jesus, if it's you, command me to come and I'll walk on the water. And Jesus says one word. He says, come. One word from God had enough grace in it so that a man would defy the laws of nature and walk on the water. But here's the point. Once Jesus had come, Peter had a choice to make. He could have been like, oh, I didn't think you would really tell me to come. You see, you have to have this characteristic of giving up your way of doing things for God's way of doing things in a relatively quick manner so as to experience the power of God's grace in your life. And thank God for what Peter did. Peter went ahead and he, you know, Jesus gave the word and he went ahead and he followed that commandment. He followed grace and he got out of the boat and he walked on the water. And so it's the same for you and I today. You know what? When you hear God's, when you find God saying something to you, if you'll go ahead and you'll abandon your way of doing things and you'll go ahead and do things God's way, whether it makes sense or not, you're going to find grace come into your life in a powerful way, and it's going to lead you in victory. Because you see, grace comes to the humble. God resists the proud. God pushes away the people who are unwilling to give up their own way, who are bent on doing their own way. And really what we're saying is, you know what, God, I kind of know better than you. I'm not willing to do it your way. I'm going to do it my way because, you know what, I think I can make it. I think I can make it. You know what happens? We close the door on grace. And then we come to the end of our life and wonder where God is. And God has been there the whole time trying to give us instruction and give us commandment and give us a plan, give us somewhere to go. But we've been denying God's grace because we're unwilling to yield to what God wants us to do. And so that's how grace comes into your life. You're gaining truths. Grace is made available to you, all right? And then once you gather those truths, you got to follow those truths out. Can I say it to you like this? You ever heard this term? Knowledge is power, right? And then somebody will come along, like Pastor Luke, and be like, knowledge is not power. Application of that knowledge is power. That's good, though, bro, because that's what we're saying. You get the truth. I love you, man. I really. You get the truth, right? You get the truth. Grace is made available, and then you live it out, and then it takes you to victory. Tonight, if you got something good from God's word, go ahead and give him a great big...